What is it? How does it originate? How does it affect us? Some key points that I want to talk about. Number one, involved in constant change and still changing. Number two, we're going to talk about the definition of emergency management. We'll go over the goals of emergency management and the laws, acts governing emergency management. How it got started. We're going to cover dramatic changes in emergency management. I'm sure you're all thinking about that right now. And then emergency management trends. This is your key points, your goals that you need to learn. Okay? Do I have any questions before we get started? Okay. Emergency management has evolved. I gave it a 3 C's. Changing in concept. In time. Changing amending of law. Can anybody tell me how you think emergency management is changing? In what way? Based on these two concepts. Concept and time. Anybody know? Anybody offer anything at all? Yes?
Different situations, different time of, you know, time of civilization, I guess.
Okay. That's true. Different situations is a huge one. Anybody else?
I'm going to say that probably back in the 50s that people weren't as worried and have to deal with terrorist type actions, and now that's kind of forefront.
Very, very true. We're going to cover that a little bit in a second. Very good. Very good. Thank you. It's also changing culturally. Okay? New adaptations. Terrorism. Active shooter. That's a big one. They're getting more and more involved every time. Language barrier. Anybody think of any other ways that the emergency management is evolving on a cultural level? Cultural level. Anybody? We'll cover that in a bit. It's cycling. Constantly cycling, okay? Our changing images of ourselves, our nation, our ideals. Here you start talking about Second Amendment right to bear arms. 9/11 is also cyclical change. Terrorist threats, they're all over the place. Any other ways emergency management is involving in cyber security? Want to volunteer anything at all?
How about social media?
So we're going to discuss that a little bit. What is emergency management? Can anybody tell me what your idea of emergency management is? How would you define that? If Dr. Taylor gave you a test and asked you what emergency management is in your head, in your mind, what would you say? Anybody? Pardon me?
Managing the emergency.
Yeah.
When an emergency happens, just how it's controlled, what actions are taken to maybe minimize what's going on.
Well, the answer, according to International Association of Emergency Managers, it's like a think tank, is emergency management is a managerial function charged with creating the framework within which communities reduce vulnerability to threats, hazards, and cope with disasters. That's the definition of it. So basically, you can come up with different ideas about what emergency management is, can't you? Some of the goals of emergency management. Excuse me, I need some water. Number one goal, reduce loss of life. Nobody's going to argue with that, are they? Number two, reduce property loss and environmental damage. That's what we do when we do 8 Days of Hope. In my case, Team Rubicon USA and 8 Days of Hope. That's property loss and environmental damage. Protect jurisdiction from all hazards. Okay? Why? Let's talk about why. Number one, threats and hazards exist and always will. Is there any way we can make this like without questions so they can, you know, like the first one, the second one, all that? That's okay.
Sorry, I could.
Disasters have huge impacts on humans and the environment. In what way? Anybody tell me about that? Why disasters have huge impact on humans and the environment? Anybody know? Can you generally say?
True. Although it didn't happen here in America, I think about the nuclear plant, the meltdown thing that happened in Japan.
Oh, yeah.
That was...
Fukushima or something?
Yeah,
Fukushima. I can't remember the name of it.
Had that happened here, that would have been a definitely a big deal for the environment.
Well, a simple thing is like, if they're not a simple thing, but let's say the college started on fire. Okay. And you had everybody in the, all the fire departments and everything in here using everything that they needed to do to put out these fires. Well, they could use water, they could use the foam and all this other stuff, but that may damage the environment in the long run. It may run down in the streams and things like that. So you gotta get people more involved in what happens after that, you know? So we put the huge fire, or use a chemical fire, for instance, right? You, big old chemical plant. Put out the fire in a chemical plant. But then what's left? All that residue and everything running down into the water, into the ground, into water, and things like that. So that those are some of the concerns that we need to address. We must be well prepared and organized to deal with disasters. You can't just take it, you know, willy-nilly. You got to have things in place. You have to have programs and stuff in place. These concepts and actions actually work. They've been tested time and time again. Hurricane, especially right now, Hurricane Harvey, Hurricane Irma, and what's the big one in Puerto Rico? Americans have expected, think back in history, okay? We'll start with right here. In the early days, preparation was up to the individual. Okay, the immigrants and stuff came to America, they started their farms, they started their areas and things like this, especially their farms. They were very close to God, okay? But they also knew that they had to prepare for things. They had to prepare for things like floods, droughts, tornadoes. They knew that they had the knowledge and they had the experience that they knew that they had to prepare themselves for that, okay? The mindset nowadays is Americans have expected to be protected under the United States government. It's automatic, right? Okay, the government is going to take care of us. So this is the mindset everybody has. That's why this is important. Okay. What has happened in recent disasters that may have altered this concept a bit? Here's the answer. Back-to-back disasters, e.g. hurricane. They're very tough for the Department of, for the Department of Homeland Security, excuse me, to handle. And active shooters, what happened recently about active shooter?
Las Vegas.
We have to prepare ourselves. And they have to have a system to organize all that stuff. And those systems that organize that stuff have come from trial and error, okay? Wisdom born of pain, so to speak, all right? Anybody have any questions on anything so far? We're gonna talk a little bit about laws and acts and evolution of emergency management programs. Now, there's a lot of these here. I don't think you have to test them because there's a lot of information. In fact, there's no test, it's just a lecture. We're gonna talk a little bit about them, okay? This is how the emergency management system evolved. First one was Congressional Disaster Relief Act of 1803. They had a big fire in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. And the deal with that is it's a big port. Okay, they brought in a lot of money, a lot of prisoners, and things like that. So they lost an awful lot of money in this huge fire. Well, the government provided financial assistance, and that's the earliest form of disaster relief. The government provided financial assistance, and because there were huge revenues for the government with these provided by the commerce enforcement. So that's why the government stepped to act in that fashion, because of the money that they could possibly lose without it. Okay. Civil defense, we were just talking about that earlier, 1940s to 1960s. Y'all wouldn't remember this? Maybe your parents would. Okay. We had a little program called Duck and Cover. You'd be watching TV, and there'd be like an emergency civil defense thing, you know, in black and white TV, there'd be a big old dot and everything, followed by like a siren. And especially in school, kids would be sitting in school, and they'd have the warnings come out over the PA or something like this, or else they'd just, you know, they'd have it like loudspeakers, and they say duck and cover, so they had to get in the hallways or go down in the basement, they had to get down, put their heads down like this. They had a little cartoon called Duck and Cover. It was quite entertaining, it's a little musical thing, because this, at that time, this was a threat. It was during the Cuban Missile Crisis and things like that, okay? And that's when they established emergency shelters. The next one is the Disaster Relief Act of 1950 that authorized the President of the United States to declare disasters. Before that, they didn't have the power. Authorized the federal agencies to assist state and local governments directly. Okay. Federal Defense Act of 1950, that set up the National System of Civil Defense Agencies, what I was talking about before, duck and cover and all that. Routine defense drills everywhere, which is what I just told you about, like the schools, and amended to include the states. It wasn't just a federal thing. It was each state had their own program set up. The Federal Disaster Assistance Administration was set up. That was originally a division of HUD, which is the Department of Housing and Urban Development. That was established in wake of disasters in the 1960s and 70s. There's about 10 of them in that time period. Tornadoes, an earthquake, I think, and some hurricanes. And in this time, it focused on the natural disasters, not so much from civil defense, because the threat of nuclear weapons and the Cuban Missile Crisis and the Russia-Cuba thing and all that stuff was starting to slow down a little bit. Okay. 1979, FEMA was created by President Carter, established by executive order, formed from the Disaster Relief Acts of 1969 and 74. And that was responsible. They assumed, in that act, FEMA assumed responsibility for all these areas. And this is why FEMA is so called, one of the reasons why FEMA is so called today. Civil defense, Federal Insurance Administration, I don't know, I'm not so sure about what that would be involved in. Emergency preparedness, the programs themselves, and U.S. Fire Administration. And then came the Stafford Act, 1988. This is what FEMA got their teeth from, because it had a lot of things to do with finance. Okay. Amended Disaster Relief Act of 1974, financial and physical assistance through FEMA. Before that, people could not get the money they needed to get the programs. The more stuff you have going on, the more money that you need for those. It covered all disasters, hazardous, and terrorist events. What event occurred that completely changed disaster relief operations?
9/11.
It changed. It just flip-flopped. Everything just flip-flopped. The whole focus, the whole concept of emergency management changed. 9/11, Homeland Security Act. 2002, enacted by President George W. Bush, largest government reorganization in 50 years, that's a long time, created the Department of Homeland Security, which now FEMA falls under. Focused on terrorism, security enhancement. Okay, now suddenly the focus is not that much on the disasters and all that other stuff. The money and everything is being channeled now into security, terrorism, because we want to stop those terrorists. It was one of the things in Iraq situation. secure and manage borders. We started realizing we had to secure our borders. We had to keep these terrorists out of our borders. We had to make the security better. We had to beef things up, you know, pass the holes in the fence, improve the radar system, that kind of stuff. And enforce immigration laws. We started getting all these programs that are leading to, and now they're quite, some of them are quite controversial. And safeguard secure cyberspace. Whoa, who does not know what the internet is? Who does not use cyberspace? We have all these programs, right? We got Facebook and what's the other one? Twitter and all these other things where people are constantly, you know, sending messages and stuff back and forth. Now they have to control that. I heard today that they hacked into LinkedIn. They hacked into, what was it, TransUnion or Experian or something like this, the places that approve people's credit and all this stuff. That can all have huge impact on stuff. Resilience, rebound to disasters. If this Blue Mountain College was wiped out, could we rebuild? We have the resources to rebuild ourselves. Okay? We have the people inside have the strength and the resilience to come back and, you know, business as usual. Okay. The next one is Homeland Security Presidential Directive 5, basically, that establishes the National Incident Management System. That's in an organization such as FEMA and everything. Everything falls, and you've got so many things. You've got the senior commanders, you've got the fire chief, you've got the police chief, you've got the safety people, you've got public relations. It's just all one big old, what do you call it? The chart, organizational chart, one big old organizational chart, and everybody has a place in there. This National Incident Management System set it up very well. As one single comprehensive system. Post-Katrina Emergency Management Reform Act. Katrina changed a lot of things also. Okay. 2006, reorganized and empowered FEMA to fix response gaps. After all these responses that they had with 9/11 and all this other stuff that happened, they have a backwash when they get done. Okay, let's talk about what happened. What did we miss? What are the areas that we didn't cover? This one covered those gaps, those response gaps. Disability coordinator for special populations. That is huge. Special populations is huge. A lot of people don't think about that. Okay. If you have a flood, then you got to evacuate everybody, right? But you got a nursing home over here, and you got people in there that need oxygen, need medication. Okay. You got older people that can't move around. Okay. Or you have a hospital, a maternity ward, right? Women in an advanced stage of pregnancy are considered special populations, in case anybody didn't know that. Okay. Because you have to make special arrangements for them to be evacuated in an emergency. I attended a lecture on special populations. I've got like several different things specifically about special populations, what happens during an emergency, how each person gets involved, background of the special ops. If you ever want to see that, Dr. Taylor, I'll be glad to show it to you. National Emergency Family Registry. How do you find all these people after these disasters? The Hurricane Katrina, they got scattered everywhere. And the record, they couldn't locate them. Some of them ended up in some places that they had never been to before. They couldn't find them. It took them forever to locate these people and get them back to where they needed to get to be at. Can you imagine the impact of, let's say you're Hispanic, and you couldn't speak English very well, and they sent you a community that nobody spoke Hispanic. That would be terrible. So you want to get relocated where you're more useful. Transportation assistance to relocate displaced persons, that goes on underneath the National Emergency Family Registry, a locator system. Case management assistance to address unmet needs. People actually sat down, case by case basis, find out, okay, we've done this for you, we've done that for you, what else can we do? Here's the resources available. You can see the people at this church or they got food assistance over here, or they got, you know, more clothing available in this area right here. And then you have President Policy Directive, PBDA, which is all nation perspective, strengthen security and resilience of the United States. It's everything you had before that you strengthened. In this case, the focus went to all measures of service and cybersecurity, pandemics. Okay. That bird flu was avian flu, I think it was a pandemic. Pandemic is something that's just starts small and just gets really, really huge. Like, let's say, I don't know what health issue they would have right now, but let's say scarlet fever was bad, okay? Somebody had scarlet fever, they didn't know it, and they have to go to France. So they fly in the airport, they check in, all this other stuff. Everybody that's touched this luggage, that's touched all these tickets and stuff, seats and stuff they sit in, every place they go is capable of picking that up, so that becomes a pandemic. And catastrophic natural disasters like Hurricane Harvey, Hurricane Katrina. The next one, Sandy, Recovery Improvement Act of 2013, SRIA, that's signed by President Obama. That also allowed things like debris removal, reimbursement, clarified. Okay, I traveled to this operation here. I spent all this money for gas and all this other stuff. Who do I go to get reimbursed for it? Okay. Sure, I volunteered for it, but I needed to get there. I needed the gas to get there. I needed food and things like this. You know, I didn't get paid for doing the operation, but I still needed this thing. And people that spent other things, like if they had to go stay in a hotel and stuff like that, and they didn't, you know, they didn't have a place to stay, so they, you know, needed to get reimbursed sooner or later. Appeals process for denials. Hazard mitigation. Now they actually have a team that goes out and says, okay, this house has been hit by a tornado 3 times. We're going to move it, or you know, we want you to move. We're going to give you these options. Put up these tornado shelters or whatever, and give you these options to reduce these hazards. And it also declared tribal declarations, identified the tribes as tribes and having their own rules and laws and so on. Okay. What trends can you see in emergency management, and what is their impact? What trends can you see? Can you see anything changing, like in TV or anything like that? We talked about, what are we talking about? Facebook and stuff, right?
Social media.
Okay. President Trump went to visit these places, okay? And some people are saying, okay, well, why didn't Obama go there? Or, you know, why did this happen all this time? You know, they watched all this stuff, gets on the news, and everybody interprets it a different way. Next thing you know, they take something small, make it huge. It becomes a big issue. And it stands in a way. It stands in the way of funding and response and people's attitudes and so on and so forth. Okay. It's an all-hazard approach to talk about all the hazards, everything. You know, tornadoes, earthquakes, the whole thing. Individual, organization, jurisdictional, shared responsibility. Okay. Bubba says, Sheriff Bubba says, the train wrecks in my county, I'm in charge. But then the county is on the county line or something like that. Somebody else's jurisdiction. I'm sorry, we're under this jurisdiction right here. So the fire department in this one says they're in charge. Police department in this one says they're in charge. It breaks down the system, gives it a unified system of command so that you know who's in charge of what operation. You don't have that confusion anymore. Interoperability, everything. Every person inside, every unit has their own ability to get things done. Cybersecurity, we just talked about that, right? Cybersecurity is huge. I can't imagine how huge that can be. They can shut down everything. Cyber terrorists can shut down everything, every operation. Credentialing and professionalism. They started using people for what they, okay, well, I used to be, let's say, well, there's a big accident, big train wreck, okay? Everybody shows up, and there's a person there that used to be an EMT, but they have these skills, okay? Well, they show their credentials, okay, I used to be an EMT, well, you know, we need somebody right now, so we're gonna use you, you know, or I used to be a firefighter, I got too old, whatever, well, you know how to hold the hose, right? Sure, okay, so grab a hose. So they have, you know, they've done that with it. And now they're studying science of disaster. they're getting more and more into what causes hurricanes, what causes tornadoes and things like this. The warning systems are a lot better, a lot faster, more accurate, things like that. How are we doing for time, though?
25 minutes.
Okay, in summary, these are the things that we discussed. Emergency management.